gotta tell you, being in the green room with Sylvia is amazing because literally seconds before we actually go live, she says something that just makes me want to die. So, hi, how are you? I did not queue up the intro today because I forgot. And that was pretty much what happened just before we hit the live button and realized, oh no, I'm not totally ready. So anyway, welcome to Kraaft It Live. I'm your host, Heather. This is how it goes. If you've never seen this show before, you're in for a treat because we pretty much don't really care about how well it goes or not. All we care about is having a little bit of crafty fun. Wouldn't you say that, Sylvia?
Absolutely. Yes, that's what we do best.
So here we are. God. We're going to have a good time. We are going to... I'm going to grab the camera so it doesn't flip back and forth every time. But we are going to be working today on soft pastels, or we're going to be working with soft pastels, I should say it that way. And it's going to be a lot of fun, I think, hopefully. And if you have not done so yet, there is a document that I've put into the chat here. If you're watching the replay, it will be linked at the bottom of this video in the description box area. So basically, what we're going to be doing is working with soft pastels. You may be asking yourself, what are soft pastels? They're kind of like chalk. I mean, that's the bottom line here. They're kind of like chalk. They come in lots of different grades. Being student grade, you can spend a whole lot of money and get some really, really yummy ones that are just creaminess, but you don't have to. You can actually purchase the inexpensive version that you find in a standard craft area in just about any store, and you can do pretty good stuff. Everything that I'm showing you today, you can do with those. Now, if you want to get into the more expensive ones, you can upgrade to like a Faber-Castell set. This is like a next step up where you can have a few more colors and a little bit more pigment so that what you're putting out there actually has a brighter consistency and definitely a little bit more pigment versus the fillers that make up the little bar for you. So that's kind of the difference. Or you can spend a lot of money and get something like Rembrandt's or something like that. Now, if you're smart like Sylvia, you got a great deal, right, Sylvia?
Oh my gosh, I got a super deal. Absolutely super deal. I'm in, where is it? Michael's. I'm in Michael's and I got a 50% off coupon for anything. And so I said, well, okay, you know, Rembrandt's are $100, $50 off. That's 50 bucks. So then I go and I check out and she says, do you have the 40% one off too? And I said, yeah, I do, but I can use that. And she goes, oh yeah. So I got them for like 35 bucks. Woo!
Yeah, so... So a little bit of jealousy going on there, okay? But, you know, so she's got some great ones, and it's not really about the product as much as it is about knowing what to do with it. And some of you may even have these things sitting on your shelves, and you've just kind of looked at them like, I don't know what to do with that. So we're really hoping that today is the day that you pull them out and that you'll play along. Now, if you knew about the document that I made, which should have given you a supply list of all the things that you needed, one of the biggest things that you need today, if you're going to play with these wonderful yummy products, is clothes that you don't care about too much, like this apron. I do care about it a lot, actually, but it's for protecting my clothing from things like chalk dust, and there's going to be a lot of it. So you really need to have clothes on, sometimes a paint smock or you know, an old denim shirt with the sleeves rolled up. That's a perfect thing to put on if you don't have one of these fabulous Kraaft Shaak aprons. But either way, whatever you need to do to cover up so that way your mess that you make is on the messed up clothes and not on you, because it is a messy project today. And then the other thing that you really need are baby wipes, because there's a lot of times where you're going to go pick up another piece of chalk or a piece of pastel and your hand has a lot of dark color on it and you can ruin your pastels that way. So we're going to talk about that as we go, and I think that's it. Oh, the other thing you need is like an old sock.
Put a sock on it, everybody.
Yeah, you need to put a sock on it. So here's the thing. This looks really disgusting, but that's because I use a lot on chalk pastels, and we'll talk a little bit about that. So do you need a sock? No. A rag will do nicely, and I'll show you some of the other tools that you might want to use too. So let's switch cameras while you talk about today's message and those who have joined us already.
Okay, let's go to today's.
I'm going to put you on camera, Sylvia.
Uh-oh. Okay. Hi, everybody. Okay, today's message is, and let me get this on camera here. God is showing you what you need to do. What does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. That's Micah 6:8. What a beautiful message, and that's so right on in today. Thank you, Heather, for that. And I just want to give a rousing shout out to all the people that are watching today. We've got Michael. Hi, Michael. Nanette. Glad you're here. Sandra. Kathy Gillette, whose birthday is today. And when Woo-hoo! We're done, we're going to sing happy birthday to her. So everybody,
you know,
get ready.
We should do the after crafter party just because it is her birthday, and then sing to her there because we can't do it online.
If I did my made up one. Okay, fine. We'll do it after. Okay. And then Beth Sin is here, and Jazzy is here, and Anamati, who is over in Finland. It's nighttime, but she stays up for us because she can't miss us because she loves us. And then Josie Dito is here. Josie, I have been following Josie for a long, long time, and she's over in Italy, and this is her first time joining us. Josie, thank you so much.
Woo-hoo! And then happy to have you, Josie. I love watching your videos, darling.
Yeah, she's amazing. And then Christian is here, and then we have Beth Brown. How exciting. We got a full gang here. Wow.
All right, so I'm going to switch cameras now. So you're no longer on. You're off the hot seat. Thank you, my dear. All right, so here's what we are going to be working on. You are going to learn how to draw this, and you are also going to learn how to color them so you have depth and dimension, okay?
Ooh,
that's where we're headed. This is where we're headed. So basically, as I stated in the document, and for those of you who have not accessed it yet, it is in the chat box up there somewhere towards the top. So basically, I shared with you some of the supplies that you're going to need today, and one of them is this Strathmore, I'm going to grab it over here, grayscale. Now, I buy it in a huge container thing.
Wow.
It is like ginormous. I mean, look at this. I'm going to show you up here. This is ginormous, right? Okay.
Wow, so, that's huge.
Yeah, so it's 18 by 24, and I get 15 sheets. It's 80 pounds. It's 80 pounds, and it comes in multiple grays, so from white to black. You've seen me use it on the dragonfly. This is the same paper I used for that dragonfly piece that we made. Mm. It has multiple grays and then some whites, okay? Let's see if I'm showing you this. Probably not. Okay, there we go. Some lighter grays, some darker grays. I'm just grabbing one of the mid-tones for today, and then I cut it down into 4 sheets. So it's a little bit easier to handle, you know, in this size. It's like, well, it's a quarter of the whole thing, so whatever that is. Let's see. It's about 13 by 10. So it's you know, that's a manageable size, okay?
Heather.
Yes, darling.
Okay. We saw you measure that. Can you tell us how you measured that so quickly?
So Nanette did this really awesome thing the other day. She shared with Sylvia and I that she, I'm going to try and tilt this up here. She uses tape. Like, this is washi tape that I have. I think I got this washi tape from Sherry in her Etsy store, but washi tape that has a measuring tool on it, and use that to tape down my freezer paper. And because that's on there, I was just able to go really quickly. 6, 12, 13. It's about 13 inches long. So pretty smart, huh?
Yeah, that's an amazing tip. I love that tip.
Yeah, we have some pretty genius people in our crafters community. If you haven't been there yet, it's a great community on G+ where you're going to meet a whole lot of smart people. And I hang out there because of that. I really do. All right. So I've got a few of these sheets. And the first thing that we're going to do with these is pull out our soft pastels. And I've got a couple here. I linked as much as I could in the document so that way you could go see exactly what it is that I'm using. So we won't spend a lot of time talking about it. But take a look. I want you to see how broken these are. This is normal. Sometimes you want little pieces. Sometimes you want even littler pieces. Because you just do. That's just how it is sometimes. And then you do want a larger piece, and I'll show you those reasons why as we're playing. But this is a good thing. You want to break them at times. It's okay. So don't worry about it looking broken or the pieces falling apart and stuff like that. It's totally okay. That is how you're going to want it. Now I will show you my Faber-Castell set, and I'll actually have both out so that we can show the difference as we're playing. It's nice because it comes with, in the lid, it gives you like all the little colors, and you could just take your chalk and go over it and all that kind of stuff, and have, what do they call these, swatches? You could have a swatch on your lid. I obviously don't do that, but you could. All right, and then they, and then it even has this foam piece to keep your pieces nice. But see how little these ones are to begin with?
Rarely
do I have to break these because they just are already little. But then it makes it harder to do large pieces of work. And I actually used both of these sets to do the Christmas thing that I did a couple years ago in front of my church. And it was really difficult to do such a large piece without larger bricks. But I wanted you to see those. Okay. So
the nice thing about that is getting those little pieces like that is you get a nice variety of colors too, instead of getting the full sticks.
Yeah. So here in a 72 set, piece set, that's what I'm trying to say, you do get a lot more color variation, but the bars are a little bit smaller. So you have to realize that sometimes. And this, again, it depends on which grade you're purchasing, because this is more of a student grade, a little bit higher quality than the cheaper kids versions you're going to find. But the kids versions are going to come less colors, but larger bars. So, okay, so now what's really funny about these two sets that I own, my favorite one is the less expensive, more kid-like version, because these are softer. And we'll talk about that. Okay, so now the thing that that I want to discuss with you first is one of the basics when you are drawing anything using any tool, pencil, marker, crayon, or soft pastels, is that you want to learn how to make marks. And I know that seems really silly. I mean, you know, duh, we all know how to make marks, right? But it's really crucial when you're playing with pastels, because I just saw Michael's comment.
Did you see his comment?
Can you bring it up on screen? Because
yeah, I'll bring it up on screen. Sure. This is so cute. Oh, Michael, you kill me.
I agree. Any size bar is good for me also, Michael. Thank you very much for that. Okay, so when we are making marks, one of the things that we want to do is obviously know how to make a line. Now, with pastels, now this is obviously used because you can see that it's not a flat square. Whereas, let me find the end of one that I haven't used yet. Okay, here's a good one. Here's a good example. So here's the end, unused. It comes like this, very, very flat and square, okay? So there's basically three different marks that we can get out of a brand new square like this. You can use the corner and create a line. You can use the flat edge and create a wider line. And you can use the flat edge of the entire bar and create an entire wide line. So these are three different marks that you can make using your different sides and angles of the pastel, okay? Now, once you've used it a while and you've used it in the ways that you tend to use it, the angles that your fingers are going to use it as, you end up with different points. And so then you get to where you can do things like this a little bit easier. Now these are really soft, so I pushed too hard there, but you can do things like this with these very fine thin lines or very thick lines. Whoops. And you can do that with your chalks as you play with them, as your pastels. I should stop calling them chalks because you can get really irritated with me if I do that. But so there's the different marks that you can make using these. Now there's also different techniques you can do as well, where you can do what's called scrumbling. And we've talked about this before. When you use small circular motions, you get scrumbling. Now if you use them looser, you get a little bit more texture to your visual. And this could be the wool of a sheep. This could be the bottom tutu of a ballerina. Okay, so based on how loose you go with those, or how tight you go, you could have different texture within your drawing. So this is all a part of mark making. Okay,
that's interesting. Yeah.
Okay, now the other thing, now look at my fingers already. Gotta wipe them off with baby wipe right away. Or if you're really nice, and you guys can't see this down here, but I'm just wiping it on my apron. So so the other thing that you can do is once you've made your marks, you can use tools to blend those marks out. And I'm actually going to use this. Let's see, let's get a yellow in here because that's going to be a nice color to add. And we're just going to make a few marks within this magenta here so you can see some blending, okay? And we'll do it over here too so we can do a couple of different types of blending. So we've made our marks, we've used our pastels to make some marks, and now we're going to do some blending. I've got a very high-tech piece of equipment known as a cotton swab. Okay, I'm going to take my cotton swab and I'm going to very gently combine my colors using the same motions. I can even flick it out so it has some movement and it will combine those colors and create a whole new color. And depending on how much I do or how little I do as to how much of that color you see below. Okay, so there's one way. Another way is to go to the makeup department in whatever store it is that you like to buy this kind of stuff in. As you know, I love makeup and I put it on every day, all day long. So this is what I buy makeup stuff for. It's really funny when I go to the store and you know, Greg and I go do store together and he says, so what else do we need? I said, oh, I gotta go over to the makeup aisle. He usually freaks out a little bit. Like, what? You never go there. Oh no, it's for crafts, honey. So a couple of things that you can purchase in the makeup aisle are these applicators. They're just a foam tip applicator. Use them, I think, for eyeshadow. Some of you girls know better than I do. And then some of these makeup sponges too, these wedges. These are two really cool tools that you can have in your arsenal. And you can do the same thing and get a little bit different effect. So here, look at how much precision I'm getting. And how I'm able to really blend those and get an orange. Can you see that? Whoops. And teach you about that in a minute. Okay, can you see the orange that I've brought out there?
It's real pretty.
That's because I was able to use this and create those two colors together to make that orange. We didn't really see that over here with the cotton swab, but definitely able to see it more here because I can just pick up a little bit of this magenta and work it into the yellow and vice versa. And then now we have a whole new color. Okay, and you can do the same thing with the swoops. Look at how precise that is.
Mm.
So imagine creating the movement in your art piece using eyeshadow brush, eyeshadow applicator, okay?
That's beautiful. Yeah.
All right, and then we can do a larger blending with this makeup sponge wedge. You can even put them together. I usually have some clips right here. I wonder where they went to. Let me take one off of the lighting here. Okay, so these little binder clips, these work awesome for this because you can clip this together to make a round surface. You can leave it flat and use the squared edge. You can use the side, creating you a really precise, sharp edge. All these different things out of one sponge. I've even seen people shove this into the end of a piece of PVC pipe and have a hold. Basically, it's a like a finger dauber at that point, right? So you can just combine a little bit. And you get a whole nother effect. Starting to look like wildflowers almost in a cactus floor, okay? So that's pretty much the basics to how you use your pastels. And you can also use your fingers. That's something I use quite a bit. And then you can also use your old raggedy sock, okay? Now what I do with this is on occasion I'll take my finger in there and it's just inside. I've found a spot that's not as dirty as all the rest. And then I will go in and make my combinations in the same manner that I did with the makeup sponge. Sometimes this gives me a little bit more control. You have to be careful about where this part is dragging So you don't want to ruin the rest of the object, but you'll see me do all of these things as I create stuff. Okay, so let's set that aside. Are there any questions before I move on?
No, just a lot of people are just commenting and saying hi back and forth to each other. Cool. Josie did say that her brother is bringing some sponges from Canada because they're so expensive here. Can you believe that? She lives in Italy and sponges, makeup sponges, are expensive.
That's a little nuts.
Yeah, I just find
not
that
what weird. I would expect at all.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so now, the other thing that I did want to talk about and I didn't get to, okay, you see the mess that I made here, right? My chalk dust. Okay, remember these ones here that I was demonstrating are much softer than the Faber-Castell set are. So when I push hard, I do get breakage, okay? You do see that. When I push too hard, it does break. And then the other thing it does is leave a little bit of dust on there. Now, the two things you don't want to do. Never, ever, ever do you want to go like this. Because when you do that, you have now swept it across your entire piece of art. So this would really be a bummer if this were a finished piece and I just went to remove all that chalk dust you see there with my hand. So that's the one thing you never want to do. The other thing is you don't really want to wet the surface, because wetting the surface would change the properties of the chalk of the pastel and give you a whole nother thing. Now, if that's your intention, that's different. But for our purposes today, we're not going to be doing anything in wet medium at all. So you wouldn't want to use your baby wipe to pick this up is basically what I'm saying. It works, but then you're going to change the properties of that whole area of the paper as well as the pastel that's there. So it did pick it up, but it does not work well for now the future application of our chalk there. I keep saying chalk. I should be like zapped every time I say that. But anyway, pastel. I meant pastel. Okay, so what you do want to do, so this is, I've told you not to do, what you do want to do is this, and I'm going to move my microphone for just a little bit. So you might not be able to hear me, but hopefully you don't hear this. That's what you want to do. Sorry if that made an awful noise, but you just want to blow it off. That's it. Just, you know, what is that Taylor chick say? Shake it off, whatever. Yeah, we're just going to blow it off. And that's it. Now the dust is gone. Another thing that you can do is tap it on your desk, which you just saw me do that. And that's how I got all those parts there. So it depends on if you're working on an easel or if you're working on an elevated or what do they call that? Inclined desk. Yeah, an easel or an inclined work surface. Then it's a little bit different depending on which one you want to use. But that's the gist of it. So I'm going to wipe this off with my baby wipe so we don't.
Okay, question for you as you're wiping that.
Yep.
Can you mix that with matte medium or matte gel and make a color?
I have no clue.
Okay.
That's, I guess, something else that we could experiment down the road. I don't know, though. I've never tried it. I would assume so. It's just a pigment powder, but it's also got other properties in it based on which.
Yeah, ooh. I know it's got, you know, some binder gum and stuff like that, maybe. So.
Yeah, and the cheaper ones have a lot of filler in them, too. So you might be competing with some other chemicals. I don't know, though.
Okay. You know, I just don't like to waste. So, you know.
I know. Yeah. Sorry, I just threw that in the trash. Probably shouldn't have, but I should have bundled it up and sent it to you. Shame on me. Okay, so then the final piece to this puzzle for me and for today's demonstration is a white pencil. And I like to use the Stabilo All pencils because I went to the trouble of purchasing them, a bunch of them, so we have them in the store. So that's why I really like to use them. But I also like that they're water soluble. So anytime I'm trying to draw something out, I like that I can get rid of it if I need to, right? Just use a little bit of water and it'll dissolve right into the background and it's no big deal. But I really like it for what we're doing today, because even though we're not going to use water, it will disappear because I can go right over the top of this Stabilo All pencil with my pastel and it goes away. It's not even there. So,
okay. Beth Brown, no, Anna Mari and Beth Brown both said that yes, you can mix it. But it works for soft pastels, not so good on oil pastels.
Oh, yeah. And we're not working on with the oil pastels today, but we will be later this month, possibly next week. Look for an announcement in the community. I'm not prepared. So yeah, exactly. And not, don't confuse what we're doing today with oil pastels. They are a whole other animal. Okay. Today it's just about these dry medium soft pastels, and it's basically like chalk. Okay. That's the way to think of them, is they are basically chalk. Okay.
Okay.
All right. So the, for our subject today, we're going to do something really simple, because we want to get past the idea of I'm not an artist, I can't draw, blah, 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 that we always say to ourselves. And we know better. We really do know better. Otherwise, why do we even have all these things if we're not willing to admit that we do like to draw, we do like to play with our supplies, right? Whatever your art is, it's creative, you're creating from your heart, so it's art. And that's the bottom line here, and that's the last I'm going to talk about that for today. But I want you to make a focal point on your paper. Whether you make it a portrait or landscape doesn't matter to me. I'm going to use landscape just for the sake of the video, because it fits better here. And then I am going to take one object, a circle, and I'm just going to put a great big one right here. Now, notice I didn't pick the middle of the page. It's just slightly above the middle page, and it's slightly to the left of the center this way. So it's this is a composition thing. So I'm going to draw a line here just so you can see. This is the center of the page. This is the center of the page. Boom. That's where my focal point is going to be, just off center a little bit. If I were to put this right smack dab in the center, it'll feel awkward and weird. Okay. So I've got myself a circle. And it's not perfect, and we don't care. And I'm trying to make it dark enough so that way you guys can see it on screen. You want to draw lighter because you want this to disappear eventually. So the next thing that I want to do is create a flower out of this. And we're just going to do it really simply. At basically the, what would be, if this were a clock, this is 12 o'clock up here and this is 6 o'clock here, right? So we're going to go between 12 and 9. To about the 10-11 time frame, and we're going to just take a line out and a line out. We're going to do that on the opposite side, a line out and a line out. Okay? And then from there, we're going to go the what would be considered the halfway point between these two. Okay? So visually, it's about here and about here. All right? Are you following along, Sylvia?
Yes, I am.
All right, good. And I want to put you on screen for just a little bit so that way people can see that Sylvia is also following along. Way to go. Okay, so then we're going to do it completely opposite over here. So basically, what we have are the structure for our petals. Now, these petals can be thin or they can be fat. They can be many and they can be few. So notice how this is the drawing that I did before. I have a much smaller center and a lot more petals, and some are behind and some are in front. This one has a lot of petals going in all the same level, I guess. But they're following that same rule that we just created here. So this is the basis and this is the variations. Now, the reason why we didn't start at the very top and the very bottom and create it that way is because we want to have a little bit more visual interest. Not every single flower is exactly petal on top, petal on the bottom, right?
Okay.
So that's the reason why we did that. So just to make life simple, I'm going to connect this petal here and this petal here. And these are going to be kind of flat square petals. And I'm going to end up with four. And then I'm going to come in and create a shorter line here and connect this way and then connect that way. And we're going to do that all the way around. Okay, so now this is kind of looking like a helicopter. It's looking a little crazy, like a helicopter. Now the definition of this is going to come in with the chalks. So at this point, I'm going to create myself a stem. And then I'm going to come out from behind, and I can actually show you this with, I can show you this with my white pencil, but this is basically what I'm doing. Don't draw yet, just watch, okay? I'm going to draw right over the top of this flower, my leaf, and it's going to be pretty big. Now, I don't care that it's over the top of that flower, and the reason why is because when I use my pastels, I'm going to push it to the back by bringing the flower on top of it. But I have the perfect line that I want, and I didn't have to guess where it was coming and have that awkwardness, okay? So give yourself the ability to draw a little bit. And I'm going to make the stem a little bit thicker because it's more like a tube or a straw than it is like a teensy line. And then we're going to make some definition to these petals, so don't freak out about that part. And that's pretty much it for right now. So let's see, are there any questions before we go any further?
Orla was asking about, you know, gray paper. So I just put a little comment that you're using pastel paper.
Yeah, and it doesn't matter the color. The only reason why I'm using the gray for today is so that way you can see it. Because if I were using white, it's difficult to see it on camera. So use whatever you want, whatever you have. Watercolor paper doesn't work as well, but it'll work. It just doesn't work as well. That's all.
And I just want to say a quick little shout out to the newbies who have joined us. Not necessarily newbies, but they're just joined us. Is Peg is here? Yay, Peg! Woo! And Claret is here. Claret Bell Woo! Is here. Yeah, so glad awesome. That everybody's here. Nice big awesome. Group today.
Definitely. Okay, so I'm going to pull out a few colors, and they're underneath my picture. So let's see. I've got yellow. I've got an orange. You know what? I did this last week. I did yellow and orange last week. We're not doing that. I'm putting those back. I just realized I did this exact same color scheme last week. We are going to switch it up, and I'm going to go turquoise, some teal, and a darker blue. And then we're going to have a light green and a darker green. And the reason why I'm pulling these out is because once I get started, I won't know what the heck I'm doing. I really won't. So it's better to have the variation out visually for me right now. And I'm using some from the other set as well because it does have a little bit more varied colors over there. So,
how many greens are you using? Three?
I've got three, and I've got five of the blue. Six. I've got six blue. I don't know if we'll use them all, but I want more variation here. Okay. Now, the reason why I'm using this much variation is because I want to be able to show you lights and shadows. If you are not... you know, you don't have all of these colors like I've got sitting over here, don't worry about it. Use white or an off-color white. If your set does not come with a white or a black, then you need to purchase those separately because you need a white and you need a black, okay? Or at least a dark gray if you don't have black. So I'm going to grab a dark gray and I'm going to grab a white. All right, so now I'm going to start with clean hands. That's the first step to this whole mess. Start with clean hands and dry them a little bit on my apron. That's what the apron's for. All right, now I'm going to go in with my color. And because this is quite a large area here, this flower is quite large, I am going to need yellow anyway. I said no to yellow, but I'm going to need it for the center. So there's a yellow. Okay. So I'm going to take my darkest blue, and the reason why I'm starting with my darkest blue is because the difference with pastels is you add lights on top. So you want to start dark and build forward rather than laying in all of your lights that you would with like watercolor or something like that. So you want to start with those darks, and I'm just going to go in all the way around my flower with using the large edge of the pastel, and I'm going to block in everywhere that I have those petals. And it's going to look really, really lame for a little while until we work on the details. All I'm doing is laying in the color. Now the next color that I have it's still a dark blue, but it's lighter. I'm going to go around the outside of the flower with that for the sky, basically. And notice that I'm not doing the entire page. Anywhere that there is paper to put it on behind the flower, also behind the petal. Or what is this thing called? It's a leaf. Hello. It's not easy to talk and draw at the same time. I've noticed that over the years. Okay. Okay, so now that looks really lame at the moment, but don't worry, we'll fix it. All right, going back in now with the next color that I have for my flower. Actually, I'm gonna stop that and go into the leaf now. And I've got my darkest green, and I'm going to lay in where I see that leaf pattern. And see how quickly we're able to add some color to this by using the broad edge of the pastel. Okay, so now's where the fun begins. Now, first of all, I can still see a lot of that gray behind in those petals, right? You can see that. It seems like there's very little color on there. Okay, the before I do anything, I'm going to give it a little puff of wind here to get all the chalk dust off of my paper. And I think I'm gonna go back in with that petal color and actually add a little bit more color to some of these areas that were just too gray. Okay, that's a little bit better. I like how much darker that is. And we're going to add that center. Okay, so now we've got our base colors down. And I want you to see something. I grabbed the yellow without wiping my fingers off, and see my fingerprints on the yellow. That's not a big deal. I can just take a cloth and wipe them off. But now I have to clean my pastels because I did not wipe my hands first. So shame on me. Okay. Now with the next darkest color that I chose for the flowers, I'm going to go in and add some definition to some of these areas coming out from the from the center. And you'll notice as I do this, hopefully you can see that it is mixing. Let's see if I can show you. Can you see that? It's kind of mixing a little bit. So we're getting a variation in the color, and we're starting to get some definition of what's going on with these petals. Now my lines have kind of disappeared, but visually I know they're there because I put them down for one thing, but also because this is a simple drawing. All right, so I just went around. Now you saw me go around in the exact same swoop with my wrist, right? I used the same angle every time and turned the paper. If you're unable to turn your paper while you're doing it, then you'll need to turn your arm and create that same swoop so it don't have a weird line coming out from the center. All right, grabbing the next color. Am I going too fast, by the way, Sylvia?
No, I'm keeping up. I'm just slow. Right.
I just want to make sure I'm not going too fast, but of course, you know, this is supposed to be a demonstration, not a perfect how-to, right? You can pause and go back later. Okay. So with the next color, I'm going to add some highlights and define these petals a little bit more. So I'm coming out on this one and coming all the way to the end. And then I'm going to add this a little bit of ruffle. And I'm going to do that all the way around for each and every petal. One side up, and then a little bit of ruffle. One side up and a little bit of ruffle. Now, did you notice that there's a little bit of variation between the height of this one and this one and this one?
Yeah.
Can you see that? That's why we didn't care about it looking like a helicopter before, because we're going to make it matter with our pastel. Okay, so now we're going to go again, come forward. And this one's a little bit bigger, so we want to go all the way down there. Off the paper, that's what we want, adds visual interest. And now we're going to do it again with this one. And this one's a little bit bigger. And you know what? If you missed some of those lines, if they've kind of disappeared on you, who cares? Make up a new one then. All right, see what we've done there? It went from being a simple helicopter style drawing to an actual flower. Now you can see these petals, they have a little bit of movement to them, right?
Yes.
Let's go back in with one of those darker colors that we used. And now we're going to use more of the corner, and we're going to add just a little bit more lines. Now these are just straight lines coming towards me from the center, just to add a little bit more depth to the underside of those highlights we just created. I'm trying to do it slow so you can see that I'm just adding. Remember, we talked about this when we were drawing, I think, when we were coloring last week, I think. I hope that's when we talked about it. Otherwise, I'm saying something out of turn. But basically, when there's light on one side, there's going to be dark on the other. So in order to keep this highlight from looking flat, you want to go to the opposite side of it. The highlight's on this side of the flower. So we want to go to this side of that petal and draw a darker line under it. And then voila, it pops out. Did you see that, or do I need to zoom in?
Do it again.
Okay, here we go. Do it again on this one. Get out of my way, plastic. Okay, here we go. All right, so here, this one is very flat. I'm going to zoom in just a little bit and see if that helps, okay? Okay, so this one here is very flat looking. It's just a light blue line. No real definition of it. But then once I go to the opposite side, which is at this point, it's the left side of the light blue line, and I make a thin, dark line underneath it, it pops out. Okay? Do that all the way around. All right, add some of those same lines to the center, and you'll make some of those folds that we see in those petals. Now, I'm not using any kind of a reference or whatever, so don't ask me what kind of flower this is. This is just something we created on our own. Okay? All right, so let's zoom out just a little bit more so we can see the whole picture again. Are there any questions before I move on to the leaf?
How do you keep your pinky finger from erasing other parts of the drawing?
I am never putting my hand on the paper. So I'm using the, let's see if I can do it again. I got to clean my hands because I've got a lot of dark blue on them. And I'm trying to show you everything that I'm doing. So if I leave something off, please ask. Please ask. Okay. So dry them off on the apron, because wet hands grabbing a piece of pastel is not a good thing. Okay. So when I pick up the green, let's see, I've got these mixed up again now. My neutrals need to be up here. All right. When I pick up the green, I've got the next lightest color, the mid-tone that I've chosen. When I am doing this, my finger is up in the air. The only thing touching it is the chalk pastel. So even when I'm doing it flat, I don't have anything touching the paper on purpose. I might hold my hand down over here because I don't have it taped down to a board, which I always tell you guys you should do that, but I don't do it. But so let's just go in here and I'll show you what I'm talking about. So I'm going to, again, using this, the wider edge of this, I'm just going to lay in some on one section of. So here we are with the leaf has got a lot of light color on it, but not the whole thing. So I don't want to destroy that dark that's underneath, that darker tone. So now I've got a lot of chalk dust here. And now I don't. Now I'm going to go back in with the darker one, and we're going to do some more of those same tricks that we did up here. And actually, no, before I do that, let me back up. I need to add some light in here. So I've got the lightest green, and now I'm going to do basically from the bottom on this edge, because this edge is coming towards us. whereas this edge is going away from us. So that's where we're going to put the darker, is in the edge that's away from us over here. Okay, so now what I've got here are three different colors, basically. Three different shades of green sitting on top of this leaf, and it doesn't look very natural. That's where my dirty sock comes in. Now, it's dirty because I've used it for pastels. It's not dirty because the husband wore it. I promise. I wash it first. But I've got several of these so that I've got a clean spot I can put my finger on. And then I'm just going to very lightly, allowing the material of the soft sock to act as my blender. And I'm just going to bring some of that dark towards the center. And I'm going to bring some of that light towards the center.
Now, you didn't switch the position on your sock, right? You just kept the dark.
Yeah, it's all the same. Yeah, okay. It's all the same. See, same exact area on my sock, green mixture going on. And that just allows it to kind of soften out a little bit and blend some of those areas. But it's not a lot. I mean, you'll see as you start doing it, there's not a lot that you have to do to make it blend some. We can now change the position on our sock and do some of the same blending with our flower. And this time I'm going to start at the top of this petal and work towards the center. Just little flicky swoops to blend some of that in so we don't have all that texture of the paper underneath showing through. Can you see that? Notice I'm again using the same directional swooping of my wrist and moving the paper to achieve it the whole time. All right, so there's my flower so far. I need to add the stem. So we're going to go in here with the dark on the left side. Okay, so here let me explain something that I just experienced. I'm going to put this aside for a second and bring back our little testing sheet, and I'm going to flip it over to the other side. I want you to see what I just experienced, okay? When I'm using this piece right here, there's some really dark spots on here that won't really mark very well on some of the, like when I went to draw on here, it just wouldn't mark. And the reason why is probably because it got wet when I wiped my hands with the baby wipe. And so now I've just got to use this piece of scrap paper over here to kind of get off that dirty part of my... Can you see that? It's really dark at the top.
Yeah.
Okay, that's... It's almost like it's... Okay, here's how I would explain it. Do you remember using a number two pencil in grade school and the eraser wouldn't work sometimes, so you would like... erase on your jeans?
Yes.
Until it would work. That's what we're doing. So we are basically making it so that it doesn't have those oils from my fingers inhibiting the stuff coming out, or the baby wipe wetness that I've created a barrier that, see how it won't mark? There, now it marks. Okay, so that's what you want, some scratch over here so that way you can do that with. It doesn't happen as much with the more expensive ones because you probably, if you invested in them, you know how to use them a little bit better. So you don't do that kind of stuff to them too much. But basically, that's how you fix it so that you can use it again. So now, go back in here and voila, it works just like we intended it to. Okay, so that was the dark green for the stem. Now we're going to do the brighter green for the highlight on that stem. And again, we're going to go in with our sock on our finger and just like simple as that. Go back in and make some details of our leaf. And just really simply pull them out. If you don't like how harsh a color, a line is, like I don't really like how harsh this light green is over here, I'm just going to go in kind of fix that a little bit. You could work on this day and night, really, you could, till it's all finished. The center is still a little lame, so we are going to, let's use the sponge, the makeup sponge for this one. And I'm just going to, from the center out, using a circular motion, I'm just going to blend this until it looks the way I want it to. I'm probably going to leave a little bit sharper yellow edge so it will define that center better for me. Okay? At this point, it's almost done, but look at our background. That background looks kind of weird. So again, that's where another sock comes in, or the same one if you haven't been using them up like I have. And of course you can use a rag or whatever, but this is what I've had for eons now for these. But I'm just gonna grab it and I'm gonna pull it out away from the flower. And I'm using a little bit more force than I did with the others because I really want this to blend out and to look very much like it's the whole background has been painted and we left all of the shadows and everything behind the objects that we're interested in. And it's just a light rub, and then it pulled it out towards the edge of the paper. Now, I've always told my art students, don't forget to sign your work, because if you do, I'm going to take credit for it and sign my name to it. So that's the last thing that you have to do, and then we're done. And I like to use something that's going to stand out a little bit. You might not want to. Depends on you, but... there we go. That's my piece right there. Now, if you want more highlights, that's where your white comes in. Maybe you want to add just a little bit of white here. Using my finger, I'll blend that in. It'll definitely give it a lot more of a curve. And it'll kind of look like that petal, that leaf is kind of bending forward a bit right there. And then maybe it disappears towards the edge. Just giving it a little bit more movement. Maybe we want to have some highlights on this flower's center here. We're getting a little bit more advanced. Don't want anybody to feel like they can't do this. A little bit of highlights here and there. Just kind of blend them in just a tiny bit with that finger. Anywhere that you think that the sun is going to be caught on it, that's where the white is going to hit the top of it, the peak. Notice I didn't add too much, but look at those highlights. Maybe I really just think that this one right here is curving towards me the most. It's kind of got some deep, dark valley in here because it's really puckered away from the rest of us right here. And there is our flower. We're done. So I don't know if that helped anybody learn to use their soft pastels, but that was our goal. So hopefully in the comments, you'll let me know if that helped you and it made you a little bit less intimidated of pulling them out and doing something with them. There are so many different things that you can do with soft pastels. You can actually use them white or wet. I don't know why I said white. You can use them wet. You know, I don't have pan pastels, which are the large pans of the same thing that you would use a tool to do. I know that I've seen many of you, especially Peg Robinson, doing some great work with those. I don't have those, but I do know that if I were to take my little applicator like this, I'm going to set this aside and pull out another piece here. Actually, let's go back to this one that I had started but not finished. If I were to use this as a pan and put some color onto it, so I'm using it in my tray over here. So let's do it this way so I can use a color that you can see. So can you see me doing this? Okay, here we go. So I've got my little applicator and I've got it on the pan basically I've made my own little pan here, and now I can go ahead and I can add that color in and paint with it just like that. That's a much slower, tedious process, in my opinion. So I like this, the way that I showed you how to use it today. This is my favorite way to use it. At this point, the next thing that I would do would be to seal it with some Spectrafix. I would seal it with this. I would just hang it up so that it was like up here on a board or something, a clip or something like that, and then give it a good coat with this. Follow the directions. It tells you how far you should be away and how long you should let it sit before another coat if you feel it needs it. The best thing to do with these is put it behind some glass and hang it on a wall. That's the best way to preserve it. The other thing would be to, if you want to travel with it or take it somewhere to be framed, that kind of thing, use a sheet of wax paper over the top and tape it to the back so that way the wax paper will protect your piece until you get it to the framing shop. So those are my suggestions, and I want to click over to Sylvia's artwork so you guys can see what
Sylvia made. No, you don't.
Yes, I do. Look at that. And I love the variation you're putting into the background. That looks great. Yeah, I love it. Don't you guys think she's did a great job? Let's see. Hold on a second. It'll take me a minute, but I can do it. So it's really good. I hope that everybody has had a really good time with this, and that you are willing to share your artwork. That's for everybody who tried. Please share your artwork with us over in the Crafters community if you haven't done so yet. Become a member, because it's a place where you can post your pictures and we all give everybody props. I've never heard anybody say anything negative, so if they do, they get their boots kicked right on out. Yeah, but that's what we do here. We encourage each other and we love to see your work, so please. And of course, you can tag it with the KSCSEP15 tag. That's Craft Shaak Challenge. whatever it stands for. It's the challenge that we do every month where we encourage you to play along with us. And if you do so and you tag it properly, then you are entered to win. Our prize for this month is a $25 gift certificate to the Craft Shaak store. That's excellent. A lot to say.
People are asking, what fixative do you prefer, Heather?
I prefer Spectrafix. No, I am not paid by them. I wish I was. I wish they would have sent this to me for free for this class. That would have been nice.
Can you tell me the difference? Because I bought Krylon workable fixative.
That works too. That works too. There's nothing wrong with them.
Well, riddle me this then. Then maybe I'm doing something wrong when I spray. Because when I get done spraying, it feels not smooth. I don't expect it to feel smooth, but it actually feels like I've put a grainy on it or something. So
yeah, and that's probably because of the aerosol. You're using an aerosol spray. This is more of a pump action.
Oh.
So I'm gonna actually fix this one while we're sitting here talking about it. This is, and I'm doing it. Remember how I told you to do it, and then I'm not gonna do it that way, okay?
Okay, sounds good.
It's not hanging up. It's actually sitting. Make sure I'm on camera here. It's sitting on my desk, so I'm doing it wrong, of course, right off the bat. But the bottom line is, it is a pump action spray. See how that is? So the reason why I don't use the one that you have, notice how dark it got. Look at that. It almost like got rid of all my color. Don't worry, it'll dry. Just don't touch it, okay? But what I do want you to know is that the difference between the one that I have and the one that you have is I'm not spraying that one in my studio. I would have to go outside to spray.
Right. I go outside with it and, you know, it's still pretty nasty out there.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's a big deal for me. I don't do that often. So I would just never spray it if I had to use that.
Okay.
But this one is supposed to be safer for pets and things too. I don't know. That's what they say. This is actually made from It says right here health safe. So this is what I'm getting at is the bottom line is that it's a safer fixative. Now fixatives are weird because fixatives don't mean it's set and nothing will ruin it. That's not what fixative means. Fixative means, especially workable fixative, means that you can do something over the top of it and not have as much destruction to the first layer. It doesn't mean it's set perfectly, so don't be confused by that. So if you go over the top of it with another layer of pastels and you are bringing up some of that other color when you do, that's just the nature of the beast. It's not necessarily going to fix it permanently to that layer and you don't have any more movement. It just protects it mostly. I hope that helps.
Yes, thank you. It helped me, I know.
Yeah. Okay, so we're going to say goodbye. We're going to thank you all for joining us for this live adventure. And for those of you watching the recording, your comments and your thumbs up and all that stuff really make us keep doing these things. And if you're thinking about hitting that thumbs down, give me a comment down below telling me why, because I really want to improve. So let us know how we can improve. That we always love around here. And if you haven't done so yet, join the crafters community. And you can always find everything that we do at craftshack.com. So we will see you guys later. Those of you who want to join us for After Crafter Party, we call it AKP. Just stick around and we'll invite you in. Okay? Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.